Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Queen Elizabeth, A Day in Her Life. In the last episode, great things were happening to the Duke and Duchess of York. They found a home to call their own, and they were very happy about the birth of their second daughter, Margaret. The family had a bit of a disagreement about what to name the princess, but they finally agreed on Margaret Rose. Little Elizabeth was very happy to have his little sister, and it was great to see how close the Duke and his family were. So let's see what's going on with the family today. When Elizabeth had a birthday that August, the King and Queen and the Duke gave her a Chinese screen for Royal Lodge. This made her very happy. She thanked the King 1,000 times for his great kindness. The birthday also made her feel older because she said, "I found 2 gray hairs," and she wrote that in caps in her diary. She stated, "I suppose one must expect this at 32, or shall I pay a visit to my hairdresser and come out platinum blonde?" So the King had been racing his yacht at Cowes, and Elizabeth hoped that the sailing had given him a rest from the cares of the troubled times. She thanked him for all he and the Queen had done for her. She said, "I was very young and ignorant of the world when I married and had no idea about what I would be plunged into, and the pitfalls were many. But Bertie was so good, and you and Mama so kind and forgiving of my mistakes, that I shall always feel grateful to you for your understanding and affection. It means so much to me, and it has helped me tremendously. I do hope that you don't mind me saying this. It somehow just came as I wrote." When the summer came, the Duke and Duchess asked the King to lend them Burke Hall rather than them staying at Balmoral. They had done that last year, and needless to say, Queen Mary wasn't happy about that. They agreed to it, but Queen Mary said there was one condition, that the little princesses would stay at Balmoral for a week as well. The Duke and the Duchess loved Burke Hall. It was a feeling of isolation in the wild, the beauty of the trees and the river outside her window. She wrote, "I'm so happy here. In fact, I'm certain that I'm a most simple creature, and I am most ill-suited to my present calling. I inherit a hermit's complex from my Leon family side, and the older I get, the more exclusive I feel." During the summer in Scotland, the Duke and Duchess visited Glasgow. Unemployment was a problem there, and Elizabeth wrote the Queen, "It was very sad to see the sad and lean faces of the men. I'm afraid there is a great deal of misery." The Duchess felt that it was the men who needed to work so much. "Women do not need employment in the same way. They can be happy when idle, but a man ought to work. I would like to make all women who have jobs that men could do give them up. I know that is impossible, but I wish it was not." On Christmas Day, 1932, for the first time, the King broadcast a message to the Empire, speaking into a microphone installed at Sandringham. Early in the new year of 1933, Duchess Elizabeth left the children with their grandparents at Sandringham. The Queen was happy, and she stated, "Princess Margaret is a great pickle and does all kinds of things to annoy Papa. Though she seems to be very fond of him, she thinks it is funny and looks up at him with wicked eyes after she has done it. She's very attractive." The Duke and the Duchess, in the meantime, were still working on their home, Royal Lodge. Elizabeth bought chairs for her bedroom, a good clock which was battered, some china, and other furniture, pictures, and chintzes. The smell of paint was in the air, and stale carpets that she hoped in time would smell better. They had to put up a shed for the garden furniture and build a meat larder. They also relaxed. They went skating on a lake nearby in the Great Park, and they decided to get a dog. In the summer of 1933, they got Dookie, the first in the long line of Welsh corgis. Generations of corgis grew up with the Duchess and her daughters. The Duke and Duchess in the 1930s started to be feeling the demands of the public. Days and sometimes engagements and their social lives shrank in consequence. They would dine with a few friends or went to see a film or a play afterwards, and sometimes they went to the cinema by themselves, but they did not go as often to dances and balls as in earlier years. Then there was a pressure to include their children in public events. The Duchess wanted to keep them out of it. She wanted to give her children the kind of happy and unfettered life she had enjoyed. In 1933, she got a young Scottish teacher, Marion Crawford, to teach Princess Elizabeth. Miss Crawford was invited for a trial visit to the family at Easter and started to teach Princess Elizabeth in the autumn of 1933. Princess Margaret joined the class in due time. And then a schoolroom was set up at 145 Piccadilly, and lessons were from 9:15 to 12:30. With a half an hour break. The princesses then had lunch with their parents, if they were at home, and in the early years there was no more lessons after that. The children would spend the afternoons out of doors whenever possible, and at 5:30 they went to their mother in her sitting room for an hour before supper and bedtime. So looking at the royal archives, Marion Crawford, from letters and timetables, was a serious-minded young woman who did her best to give her pupils the kind of solid education, self-discipline, and wide-ranging instruction to participate in conversation and make sense of the world around them, rather than to excel academically. She stayed with the princesses for 15 years. The Duchess didn't try and interfere in the lessons, but she insisted that she would teach her daughters Bible stories, and they came to her bedroom each morning for this. Lady Strathmore had taught the Duchess the stories when she was a child. And like her mother, Elizabeth insisted that her children get plenty of fresh air. When the princesses were older, she copied Lady Strathmore, employing a French governess. As time went on, Marion Crawford didn't find the Duchess very supportive. She said that sometimes things were not made easy for me. Even when Elizabeth was 11, her mother was hesitant to allow a full school day. The governess wrote that I had been more or less commanded to keep afternoons as free of serious work as possible. The governess would then make the most of it by giving the girls lessons as they walked. And then Crawford's timetables were often disrupted by the distractions like dentists, tailors, and hairdressers, who always seemed to come in the morning. And when morning swimming lessons were introduced, the Duchess allowed afternoon lessons in the garden to make up for lost time. Crawford complained that her pupils often went to bed too late, so they missed their morning piano practice, and there was a lot of yawning in class. So Crawford found an ally with Queen Mary. She was interested in her granddaughter's education, and another ally was Owen Morshed, the royal librarian, who gave the princesses regular historical tours of Windsor Castle when they got older. Queen Mary had spoken to Miss Crawford, and she told the Queen that Her Majesty constantly wanted the children at odd moments, and they needed to do their lessons. Queen Mary said that the late King and I never indulged in where lessons were concerned, and the librarian shared Queen Mary's view. He said he wasn't impressed that the 18 books recently ordered for Princess Elizabeth by her mother were all by P.G. Woodhouse. He was a humor writer. The Duchess didn't think it was necessary for her daughters to have an extensive education than she had received herself. She wanted them to have plenty of fresh air, exercise, fun, and light reading. What she wanted was no different than other daughters of aristocratic families at that time, many of whom were still taught at home. The education was imperfect. The governess had narrow experience and expertise. The princesses also lacked the companionship and stimulation of other children as classmates. They did have a couple of activities outside the classroom, like Madame Vacani's dancing classes and the Girl Guides, which were like the Brownies at that time, so that made up for it. When it was thought that Elizabeth needed a better training for a future role, her mother followed the wise advice and arranged for Henry Martin, the Vice Provost of Eton, to give her history lessons from 1939. Princess Elizabeth was taken by a carriage to Martin's study at Eton, where she sat and listened, surrounded by piles of books on the floor. Later, the carriage was sent to bring Martin to the castle. Marie Antoinette de Bellegueule taught the princesses European history as well as French from 1942 and remained a trusted friend for many years to them, and she gave them a wider outlook. She thought the Duchess, too, took little interest in their academic education. The Duchess felt that the most important thing was a moral and spiritual education, and that she got from her own mother. The Queen Mother wrote a note in her private papers in case anything happened to her. Number one, be very careful not to ridicule your children or laugh at them when they say funny things. It is usually quite innocent, and if they are silly or show off, they should be quietly stopped and told why afterwards if people are there. Number two, always try and talk very quietly to the children. Never shout or frighten them, as otherwise you lose their delightful trust in you. And number three, remember how your father shouted at you, making you feel uncomfortable, and you lost all your real affection. None of his sons are his friends because he is not understanding and helpful to them. The Duchess' public commitments continued as usual. On February the 16th, 1934, she opened the X-ray department of the Marie Curie Hospital in Hampstead. That summer, Lady Strathmore was ill again, and the Duke suffered acute pain from a poisoned hand, which needed surgery. He was out of action for weeks, and the Duchess had to go to Sheffield on her own. This was the fifth largest city in the country. The city had a large working-class population and was dealing with the depression and unemployment bravely. She wrote a private account of her visit to the city to Osbert Sitwell. She said, "It took me 3 baths and 3 days to become clean after my 2 days in Sheffield. Never have I been so dirty. Smoke, steel filings, oil, and coal dust all gathered to cast a dusky hue over my person, and 5 hours on end with the charming and very labor lord mayor completed my route." The Duchess later in the year wanted a painter named Burley, he was a successful painter of that time, to paint a group of her friends known to each other and to know others as the Windsor Wets Club. The club was founded a few years earlier with the Duchess as patroness, and it reflected her sense of mischief. The Wets were a secret group that, according to the book Queen Mother, were like-minded tipplers intent on raising their collective spirits. Their motto was Aqua Vitae non Aqua Pura. The Duchess explained later that being a secret society, we had to have a secret sign, and this was to raise the glass to other members without being seen by the disapprovers. Most of the devotees were members of the royal household, and their clandestine association enlivened the tedium of many a court function. They had a humorous correspondence about the club business, including her suggestion of a club tie with champagne stripes on a claret background. And this brings us back to the painting. They wanted to be immortalized by having their portrait painted. The Duchess was excited. She liked Berkeley's work. He accepted the job, and his excellent, humorous portrait still hangs at Windsor Castle. It shows a number of the gentlemen members of the club sitting and standing around a table laden with port and wine after dinner at Windsor. Since women were not supposed to participate in such occasions, the Duchess of York and the Duchess of Beaufort are present only as portraits on the wall, while Lady Elton peers around a screen, and the Duke of York's membership is also signaled by his portrait. It was silly, but most enjoyable, underground movement, and Queen Elizabeth said later, "We laughed a lot." So on this fun note, I'll end the video here. In this episode, Elizabeth celebrated her 32nd birthday. She had a good time, but was worried about the 2 gray hairs she found, but I think she was only joking about that. The Duke and Duchess of York had a great summer at Birkenhall, away from it all. And when it came time to educate the princesses, the Duchess didn't think education was necessary to a large extent. And that was the mindset in those days among aristocratic families. Their governors did the best she could, and later they hired Henry Martin to teach Princess Elizabeth history. It ended with the Duchess having a portrait painted of her secret club of drinkers, and this showed what a sense of humor and fun the Duchess had. Now, I'm enjoying this book so much, and there's so much to discover about the Queen Mother and also her husband and their daughters, as well as the King George and Queen Mary. I hope you enjoyed the video, and if you did, if you could give it a thumbs up, it would be greatly appreciated. And I hope everybody's been having a good day, and tune in again soon for another episode of Queen Elizabeth, A Day in Her Life. Thank you.